knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
We just got finished discussing antiplatelet pharmacology and how these drugs reduce the risk of arterial cardiovascular disease. In this tutorial, we will continue to discuss anticoagulant drugs, which influence blood clot generation, but are used primarily to reduce venous thromboembolism, atrial fibrillation, and deep vein thrombosis. Of course, both antiplatelet drugs and anticoagulants reduce the ability of the blood to form clots. When deploying either class, or in the less common medical scenario where both are used, the risk of excessive bleeding and the benefit of reducing blood clot formation are carefully weighed. In fact, this is an area of active clinical trial research. In general, antiplatelet drugs are used to reduce thrombotic disorders in the arterial system, and anticoagulants are used in the venous system. But given how delicate the balance between bleeding and clotting is, consistent monitoring and follow-up is of the utmost importance if using drugs of either class. Mechanistically, antiplatelet drugs like aspirin reduce the aggregation amplification pathways associated with production of thromboxane A2, the endogenous agonist for the thromboxane receptor, while P2Y12 receptor antagonists antagonize ADP at the P2Y12 receptor. In contrast, anticoagulant drugs target the generation of fibrin and thrombin from their precursors, fibrinogen and prothrombin. We learned in an earlier tutorial that fibrin cross-linking mesh formation stabilizes platelet-platelet interactions in thrombosis. To understand this in greater detail, we need to understand some of the details relating to the clotting factor cascade. This is a complicated signaling cascade that is important to be aware of, but generally not necessary to memorize. The consequences and endpoints of the cascade are the most critical things to grasp, and this is indeed where anticoagulant drugs mediate the majority of their effects. The clotting cascade is divided into two different pathways, the extrinsic and intrinsic pathways, which both converge towards the common pathway. The ultimate goal of the clotting cascade is to convert soluble fibrinogen to insoluble fibrin. Another key protein in the clotting cascade we have discussed in the previous tutorial is thrombin. Generation of thrombin is facilitated by factor 10A, catalyzing the hydrolysis of two proteolytic sites on prothrombin. This proteolysis is also increased by factor 5A. For a fully optimized prothrombinase complex, both factor 10A and factor 5A are required. Once thrombin is generated in the circulatory system from prothrombin, it will activate protease-activated receptors on platelets, which increase platelet aggregation, as we discussed in the previous tutorial. Thrombin also catalyzes the conversion of fibrinogen to its active form, fibrin. As we mentioned previously, fibrin initiates platelet-platelet cross-linking, which is critical in thrombus formation and stabilization. Now that we understand important aspects of the clotting cascade and the functional endpoints of fibrin and thrombin, we can begin to better understand how different drugs inhibit the clotting cascade and act as anticoagulants. There are four main classes of anticoagulants. 1. Vitamin K antagonists. 2. Factor 10A and thrombin inhibitors. 3. Direct thrombin inhibitors. And 4. Selective factor 10A inhibitors. Vitamin K antagonists, such as warfarin, inhibit the enzyme vitamin K epoxide reductase complex 1, an essential enzyme in generating activated vitamin K. Reduction of vitamin K's presence reduces the hepatic synthesis of functional factors 2, 7, 9, and 10, as well as a handful of other coagulation regulatory factors. Non-inhibited vitamin K usually aids in carboxylation of glutamic acid residues on the clotting factors discussed. Without this essential carboxylation step, factors have reduced binding affinity towards the endothelium lining blood vessels and are essentially biologically inactive due to the reduction in vitamin K-associated carboxylation of clotting factors. Through this inhibition of biologically active clotting factors, the downstream generation and activation of thrombin and fibrin are inhibited as a consequence, leading to reduced blood coagulation. Factor 10A and thrombin inhibitors target thrombin's function by reducing the generation and breakdown of thrombin. A key drug example in this class is the polysaccharide heparin. Heparin increases the breakdown of thrombin and factor 10A by increasing the activity of antithrombin. Mechanistically, heparin binds to antithrombin, inducing a conformational change that improves the rate of enzymatic breakdown of thrombin and factor 10A by antithrombin. Increased direct thrombin breakdown, as well as thrombin generation inhibition through factor 10A breakdown, reduces the ability of thrombin to convert fibrinogen to fibrin and will reduce platelet aggregation through reduced activation of protease-activated receptors on the cell surface membrane of platelets. Reduced fibrin generation and reduced protease-activated receptor activation both lead to anticoagulation. In contrast to heparin, low molecular weight heparin induces a conformational change in antithrombin that preferentially breaks down factor 10A over thrombin in a range of ratios, between 1.5 times to approximately 10 times. Low molecular weight heparin is preferred in some medical situations due to its longer duration of action, which means its dosing regimen is less frequent. Low molecular weight heparin drugs usually have the suffix parin and include dalteparin, enoxaparin, and bemiparin as examples. Direct thrombin inhibitors such as argatroban bind directly to thrombin and inhibit its activity, predictably leading to reduced protease-activated receptor activation on platelets and reduced conversion of fibrinogen to fibrin, leading to anticoagulation. Drugs in this class cause significant anticoagulation but are also helpful in changing anticoagulant treatment if heparin is causing thrombocytopenia, meaning reduced platelet count, a known side effect. Finally, selective factor 10A inhibitors such as apixaban selectively inhibit factor 10A, which leads to reduced conversion of prothrombin to thrombin, which in turn reduces platelet aggregation indirectly through reduced protease-activated receptor activity and thrombin-induced conversion of fibrinogen to fibrin. Although the clotting cascade is quite complex and involves many steps, the important aspects to remember revolve around the reiteration of the endpoints of thrombin and fibrin generation and how different drugs pharmacologically interfere with critical steps in the cascade. And with that, it's time to move on to neuropharmacology.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.